The first virus that I mentioned is the feline herpesvirus 1, otherwise known as the feline rhinotracheitis virus. And the second virus is the feline calicivirus. And this is, in some studies, found to be up to 50% of upper respiratory tract infections that it's present in. And this virus is sometimes very confusing. And the reason that I say it's confusing is that it can cause very mild symptoms where it just causes a little runny nose for a few days to a few weeks, and then it's done, just like a common cold in people. But then it can be extremely severe. It can cause very severe ulcerations of the paw pads, to the nose, to the mouth, making it so that the patient is unable to eat, unable to drink. It can cause GI symptoms to where they have diarrhea or vomiting. It can cause severe pneumonia. And in some cases, it can kill animals and patients as well. And so it's a very confusing virus because of the such drastic differences that it can have. Whereas feline rhinotracheitis virus is mostly just going to be pretty mild symptoms, and then secondary infections can cause increased symptoms compared to the calicivirus, which by itself can cause mild symptoms or death. So it's a very, very drastic difference. And in some ways it might remind you of the now what's going on SARS-CoV-2 or COVID-19 in people, where some people get it, don't even know they have it, and other people end up dying despite all medical treatments that have been tried. So that leads me up to my next story. My next story is about a cat that pretty recently came into our clinic here about 2 months ago, and it came in and was basically dead. The owners had found this cat on their garage floor. The garage had been closed for a while. It wasn't their cat. They don't know where it came from, but they found it on the floor, basically barely alive. They had seen it breathing a few times. They brought it in right away and wanted to save it. So we did our best, and this cat had a temperature of 94 degrees, had severe pneumonia, had severe dehydration, was severely emaciated. It weighed probably 1.2 pounds, if I remember correctly, where this cat normally, based on its skeletal size, should have weighed 4 to 5 pounds. So that tells you how skinny this cat was. And the biggest struggle that we had, obviously, was, you know, getting it up to temperature, treating the severe pneumonia, treating the severe dehydration. But other things that we found on initial exam were some ulcerations along the nose and in the mouth of this cat. We were able to bring this cat sort of back to life. We started treating it, giving it some mild food. We can't give food too fast for a variety of reasons, and I'll talk about refeeding syndrome in a different video. But we're trying to avoid that, and it did well for a day, and then the next night, overnight, it basically crashed again and was back to where it was at the beginning. We thought we were gonna end up euthanizing this cat because we were running out of budget, and it just did not look like it was a very promising chance this cat would live. Fast forward a month and this cat came back in. The owners had been feeding it and taking care of it and rehabilitating this cat, and she has been doing fantastic, by the way. But she still has some ulcerations on her nose and a little bit of a sniffle and a little bit of a sneeze here and there. And so I really suspect that this cat has a calicivirus. Now, the calicivirus, like I said, can be variable in its symptoms. But one of the telltale signs is that it has ulcerations on somewhere is kind of the definitive, this is most likely what it is. So most often we will see feline calicivirus in kittens and in barn cats. And this is just because they have a much higher exposure. So most often we are going to see this disease, which is the feline respiratory disease complex, in kittens and in cats that are at a high risk of exposure. And actually most kittens in the world have had some sort of upper respiratory tract infection, especially those that are born in, you know, an environment like a barn, those that are born, you know, kind of out in the wild in a sort of feral population. And it's just because they have a high level of exposure, they have, you know, a higher level of stress. And so a lot of times we'll get new kittens that come in, whether they be from the shelter, whether they be from, you know, they got them from somebody else's barn, whether it's their own barn cats, and they just have an upper respiratory tract infection. And so what do we do to treat that? Well, like I said before with the calicivirus, a lot of times these are self-limited. There's not a lot that we can do to directly treat the viral part of these infections. But as I mentioned, a lot of times there's secondary effects to these, whether it be mycoplasma, whether it be a reovirus, whether it be chlamydia, or whether it just be other upper respiratory infection causing bacteria like Bordetella or Pastorella. A whole host of other bacteria can infect these really diseased tissues from the viruses, and we can treat and prevent those with an antibiotic. One of the other things that has often been done, and this is probably mostly since the 2000s, is something called L-Lysine. It has for a while been tried to be used for herpes virus infections. And in the case of cats, there's a little bit of conflicting information, and this is somewhat of a controversial subject. There have been a few studies that have shown possible efficacy, and most of those were done in the early 2000s. However, as you can go and look at some of these studies down below, but one was done in 2015 and several others were done in that same time period as well, that showed that there was zero use for L-lysine, and in some cases, they found that it actually caused an increased disease level in cats. So L-lysine is kind of a positive or negative, and it can depend on the veterinarian. There's a whole bunch of complicated information with it that I'm not gonna get into, but suffice to know that some vets may use it, some vets may not, and there's not necessarily a good argument either way. So as a summary, your cat has an upper respiratory tract infection without being diagnosed by a vet, you're thinking it does. It has some sneezing, it has a little bit of coughing, has some discharge around the eyes and the nose. What should you do? What should you know? Well, first of all, I would go to a veterinarian. Even though these are self-limiting and a lot of them will resolve on their own, if you want the best outcome for your cat, it's best that a vet has a chance to look at them and do some prognosis, as in knowing how far the disease has gone and is going to be the best judge of if antibiotics are going to be necessary or helpful in your patient's case or in your pet's case. Some of these cats, like the one that I mentioned just earlier that probably started as an upper respiratory tract infection, she went downhill probably extremely rapidly, and it's only a miracle that she's even still alive. And so sometimes these upper respiratory tract infections can spiral very quickly. And so having a vet that is able to tell you, yes, your cat should be on antibiotics to prevent secondary pneumonia or, you know, prevent a secondary bacterial infection elsewhere, can be very helpful and can save your cat's life. One of the other things is that sometimes cats will have lifelong complications, even if they do survive. So I do expect that this cat will probably have a little bit harder time with life, as her lungs are to the point where she probably is never going to fully recover. I also have had several kittens that have come in that have actually had parts of their eye completely damaged from the conjunctivitis or the inflammation of the eye, and will never gain their sight back completely. And there's nothing that we can really do without complicated surgical procedures. And so getting ahead of it early can save your cat's life, save your cat's sight, or could be, you know, maybe irrelevant in mild cases as well. So I do recommend it if you want the best outcome for your cat. So what about the vaccine? Well, in cats there is a vaccine, and it's the same as the feline distemper vaccine or the feline panleukopenia vaccine, also normally will contain both of these top two viruses. Usually these combo vaccines are going to include feline panleukopenia virus, as well as feline rhinotracheitis virus and feline calicivirus. And so they're normally going to have all three of these things in it. And so we do recommend cats get vaccinated every year. Some clinics will say every 3 years, depending on risk. One of the other things that is sometimes found in this vaccine is the chlamydia. This can be a little controversial, and that's why it's going to be its own video following these two videos. So make sure you get your cat vaccinated. If your kitten is too young to be vaccinated and is showing these signs, go talk to a veterinarian. It's more than worth the time. So this is the end of part two of this video. Thank you guys so much for watching. Hopefully this answered your questions about feline upper respiratory tract infections. And also, hopefully this answered some of your questions about feline herpes virus and feline calicivirus. The next video is gonna be feline chlamydia, and we're gonna talk about a whole host of different things about this, including some of the complications of them getting it, zoonosis, and vaccines. So stay tuned for that, and we'll see you in the next one.